You're probably wondering why a person such as myself would come onto stage here in San Marcos or anything, sort of clutching a pair of ladies' white rubber pants. Well, no, it's not because I'm English, ladies and gentlemen. It's because these pants are actually the corporate logo of the next song. Now, I understand that you have the biggest idea what I'm talking about, but I'm going to keep judging anyway. Just listen to the soothing texture of my voice. Now, let's suppose you're a Danish boutique girl. Every one of you in this audience is, in one way or another, sort of a Danish boutique girl. And let's presume that one day in the midst of your boring festival, Danish boutique girls and existence, the great news comes to you. Yes, indeed, an important rock and roll personality from England is going to come to your town. Oh God, you're excited. You can hardly wait. Because you, as a Danish boutique maiden, must go down there and fuck one of the guys in the band. Because that's who he is, isn't it? Right? So, the band arrives in town with a typical English meeting. Hey, this is a typical English band. You go to the stage, you go backstage, you suck off all the guys in the crew, and then you do that all-important backstage pass. Later, you manage to confiscate the lead singer from the important English band that has just come to your town. You take this visible specimen home with you. You're a typical Danish boutique girl type bedroom. On the wall, a Jimi Hendrix poster. Green stick of patchouli incense. A red bulb in the lamp. And the all-important Eagles album on your record player. Oh God, it's romantic. The English person takes off his clothes, revealing his illustrious pure white Then, you start taking off your Danish boutique girl type clothing, your little brassiere, your little sweater, your little pants, your little boots, then to the little white cotton underpants with the brown mark at the bottom. Your skirt goes out of the bed real quick, because you know that the English people are very much offended by that. Of course, you have to leave your garter belt on. Then you lie back on your teenage bed, you send your legs up in the air, and the universal gesture of greeting, the English person jumps on top of your body and puts his lips next to your ear. And the next thing you know, he's saying to you, I need you. Thank you. experience you remark will always be cherished by you, and our love will go on and on as long as you keep buying my wonderful English little albums. Oh, darling, please say that you love me as much as I love you. I think you're a swell girl. I don't even care if you've got brown marks on your way to the next day. That's how you all die. Maybe it's tea. I don't know. We can't be sure about these things when we come to a strange and distant land. Well, dear, it's been nice. It's been really nice. And I hope that it will continue to be sort of nice, maybe even very, very nice. And that is why I have to finish this song by looking deep into your eyes and saying, I'm going to baby.
Surprise.
that sounds like a monster. Let's try it one time. Monster! Very good. Okay, here's the way it goes. Give me a little storybook music, Tommy. Once upon a time, there was a handsome knight named Lance Point Blitz. He had a horse named Big Hump. Big Hump the horse. He could eat the whole forest without a remorse. He was a very hungry horse, of course. One day, way past it, the gates of hell opened wide, and out stepped a really ugly monster. Obviously, because Lance Point Flint was a handsome knight, and because Big Hump was one hell of a horse, and because in the old days there was nothing good on TV, his job was to go out and kill the monster. And so, Lance Point Flint jumped on top of the very large horse, from the world's Big Hump, and rode out into the countryside in search of the monster. While riding along, Lance Point noticed that the countryside was very beautiful. He turned to the horse and said,
"The chair is so selfish."
Whereupon Big Hump turned his massive head back around and looked deep into Lance Point Blitz's beady little helmet and crusted eyes and said,
"I'm off my back, drop that upper lens, and I'll show you a thing or two."
Of course, Lance Point wasn't going to stand for any of that because he knew David Bowie personally. That's why he turned to Adrian and said,
"You have half hair."
And Tommy remarked,
"I thought I saw you last night in the convent with Uncle Pete."
Meanwhile, the monster was getting closer and closer to the castle with the little pointed roof, with the cute girl with the long yellow pigtails on the side of her head, and the pointed hat, and the little white dress that you could almost see through, and the other bad guy who lives at the bottom of the steps, where he keeps her up in the top of the thing with a point on top of it, and the monster is going over there to eat the aforementioned baby. Anyway, it was a long journey for Lance Point Blitz and a Big Hump. Remember, this horse can eat a whole forest without a remorse. I told you that already. And about this time, the horse is getting hungry. Now, the problem is, does Lance Point Blitz let the horse go get something to eat when the monster is getting so close to eat the cute girl in the thing with the point on top of the roof? This is an important question. He's thinking. He knows that in order to slay the aforementioned monster, he has to sneak up on the monster. And he has to do it very fast because the monster could eat him and the horse as well as the cute girl. He decides to act. He's going to go straight ahead. He's going to go and get that bomb-packed monster. Because he hasn't snuck any monsters for weeks now. There's still nothing good on television. He starts sneaking up on the monster. And the horse is sneaking up on the monster. And they're sneaking up on the monster. And the horse is sneaking up on the monster. But the monster can hear that the horse is hungry because the horse's stomach is growling. And so he eats the horse, Lance Point Blitz, the girl, the point on top of the roof, her dress, and the bad guy who lives in the bottom of the castle. And the moral of this story is it's very hard to sneak up on a monster when your stomach is growling.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm sorry. It's one of those sensitive, reserved, intellectual, Scandinavian, cool sort of uninvolved, sort of boring sort of audience in there, isn't it? Ah, it's one of those kind of lines that's too sensitive to sing along with a song. Oh my God! Don't tell me we're gonna deal with another one of those kind of audiences to get that. Hey, look here, ladies and gentlemen. We don't drag all this stuff from the United States of America. We're here not to have you singing Dinah-Moe Humm. I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're gonna make life really easier. You don't have to sing along with Dinah-Moe Humm. All you have to do is sing Ave Maria, okay? Let's hear it. Ave Maria. All over there. Let's hear it. Hey, look, just think of me as an older, more sinister Hans Christian Andersen. Let's go on with it, ladies and gentlemen. You need a little help? Ave Maria. Let's try it. Hey, very good. You've just heard one more song. I think this song is Camarillo Brillo. 1, 2, 3, 4!
Thank you.